A very good evening to esteemed speakers for the day, members of Ahmedabad University Management, heads of institutes, invited guests, members of the press, faculty, and my dear student friends. I welcome you all to the second Entrepreneurs Podium, ePodium 2016. Since its inception, BKMIBH has always remained committed to all-round excellence of their students, taking students for industrial visits, opportunities for internships, inviting corporate representatives to interact with students has always been a part of BKMIBA curriculum. Apart from these, I would like to highlight a few efforts that we as a team at BKMIBA carry out to shape smarter and sharper business individuals. Capstone, which is a year-long intensive research project, is taken up by our final year students. With the objective of achieving research-oriented learning, Ratnamani, which is another year-long research project, comprises of a team of students from all the years of both programs at BKMIBA and functions on similar lines, with the exception that it focuses on research, which is on socially relevant and pressing issues. We can proudly say that on multiple occasions, these projects, guided by our faculty, have been converted to award-winning business plans and research papers. Management in Practice, or MIP, is fondly known as it is fondly known, is a series of classroom lectures which are delivered by industry experts on topics which are relevant to management for the honors students of third year. Contemporary Issues in Business, or CIB, is a subject that allows students to discuss relevant contemporary corporate issues and be updated on with the happenings of the corporate world and learn from them. The subject of entrepreneurship, which is introduced in the second year, is converted into a full-fledged specialization in the third year. It comprises of three subjects: developing business ideas, establishing and growing ventures, and business plan. These subjects combine to offer 135 classroom hours, three short projects, multiple rounds of evaluations, and two final exams to ultimately mold into one detailed executable business plan. At the end of this, students compete through presentations judged by industry experts to declare the winning plan of the year. We are very proud to share that BKMIBA for the last 2 years has been offering the IMBA program, which is the integrated MBA program. This 5-year-long program focuses on imparting necessary skills and knowledge to gear students to take over the reins of their family business and to be job givers instead of job seekers. This now leads us to the question, why ePodium? Each entrepreneur has his or her own story to share. This story is almost unique in its own way, full of learnings and reflections, which we believe are priceless for our students. We wish for them to understand that to achieve success, perseverance and persistence are key. And more often than not, one usually goes through bitter tastes of failure multiple times before one sweet taste of success. Students sometimes are predisposed to believe that theories have very little connection to what happens in the real world. With the help of our speakers over the next couple of hours, we are confident of getting them to think otherwise. Their stories will most definitely enable students to connect classroom learnings better to business situations and bring the much needed rationale and prudence in their thinking to both meet and outdo their competition at large. Ratan Tata once said, "A person who has not faced any difficulties is an unreal person because he hasn't had the opportunity to deal with these difficulties." How many times have we heard that something cannot be done? It is up to us to prove that it can be done. Students, I hope all of you sitting here today will make the most of this priceless opportunity ahead of us and learn as much as we can from these renowned entrepreneurs with us today.
We are honored to have with us today three esteemed entrepreneurs, Mr. Devanshu Gandhi, Managing Director of Wadilal Industries Limited, Mr. Samir Sinha, Managing Director of Savvy Infrastructures Private Limited, and Mr. Rajiv Patel, Trustee and Founder of City Heritage Center. I request our student volunteers to please felicitate our honorable guests with a green welcome. Thank you so much for being with us this evening.
Our first speaker this evening is Mr. Devanshu Gandhi. Mr. Gandhi is the Managing Director of Wadilal Industries Limited and the Chairman of CII Gujarat State Council. He is the son of the founder chairman, late Sri Lakshmanbhai R. Gandhi. In 1990, Mr. Devanshu Gandhi completed his graduation and joined the family business. Since then, he has contributed significantly towards the success of the company. He is an effective communicator and an excellent relationship building and interpersonal skills. Over the years, he has garnered a rich experience and gained vast knowledge about the ice cream and processed food business. He is an efficient leader who possesses a strong analytical and detail-oriented approach to decision making. He has developed creative marketing skills with an effective blend of operational, managerial, and strategic leadership abilities. Mr. Gandhi is also actively involved with many prestigious organizations and institutions across the country. He holds key positions as the chairman of the CII Gujarat State Council 2015-16, Chairman of the CII Task Force in Agro and Food Processing 2013-14, and the Chairman of the West Zone All India Food Processors Association from the year 2011 to the year 2013. So I request you to please come up and give us a talk. Thank you.
Make you feel joyful when you're feeling down, loved when you're alone, lively when life is boring, simple. It's ice cream, the key to making every moment special. At Wadilal, we endeavor to make every moment not just special, but a celebration. Wadilal Ice Creams. In 1907, Mr. Wadilal Gandhi started a soda fountain in Ahmedabad and began making ice cream using the traditional Koti method. His son Ranchorlal soon joined in the venture and started Wadilal's first ice cream parlor. By 1947, one parlor had grown into four, and Wadilal became popular for its flagship Kasata ice cream. Today, Wadilal has grown into one of the largest Indian multinational corporations in the frozen food category. It has two ice cream factories, one in Pundra, Gujarat, and one in Bareilly, Uttar Pradesh, and a plant in Dharampur for its frozen foods division.
Wadilal is an industrial group operating since 1907. And we are leading player of ice cream, processed foods, industrial chemicals and real estate. Our objective is to be one of the largest MNC into the frozen food sector.
In the last 5 years, we have introduced several sub-brands like Flingo, Bada Bite, Ice Super and Gourmet to cater different age group and taste. To promote these products, we have adopted contemporary marketing practices and ad campaign, which has received overwhelming response from the consumers.
So how does one of the largest ice cream brands in India make its ice cream? It all begins early in the morning at 5 a.m. when fresh milk is collected at Vadilal Collection Centers and other milk cooperatives. This helps the villagers earn livelihoods. This milk is then sent to the ice cream factories, where it is checked and stored in large silos for cooling at less than 5 degrees Celsius, untouched by hand. So how does this milk turn into everyone's favorite ice cream? The cooled milk is transferred to the tri-blender, where it is mixed with skimmed milk, cream, sugar, etc. at 60 degrees Celsius and turned into an ice cream premix and churned in tanks. This is then sent to a machine where it is first heated to 82 degrees Celsius for 16 seconds and then quickly cooled to 5 degrees in a process known as pasteurization. This makes the ice cream premix completely safe to consume by killing all the germs and bacteria. The premix is then taken through a process called homogenization, where the mixture is given a smooth texture. It is then chilled and sent to tanks for flavoring, where a base mix is prepared. All raw materials that go into our ice cream are 100% vegetarian and are thoroughly checked for quality. Now the magic happens. The mix is sent to ultra-modern machines through high-quality stainless steel pipes. In one of these production lines, your favorite Flingo disc cones are being made. The cones are made using the finest ingredients and the latest technology. These are placed onto a conveyor belt and a machine coats the inside of a cone with a chocolate layer that will separate it from the ice cream. This is done to maintain the crispiness of the cone. Nozzles fill these cones with the ice cream. A pencil filler injects fudge right in the middle. Another nozzle tops up this ice cream with a molten chocolate disc. And finally, it is garnished with nuts. A robotic arm places a lid which is then crimped, sealing all the yumminess within. They are picked up by another set of robotic arms and placed onto a conveyor belt, which takes them into the hardening tunnel. Here, they are frozen at minus 40 degrees Celsius for half an hour in a process called blast freezing. This is a very important process that gets rid of ice crystals and ensures proper body and texture. Hey, want to know how your favorite thunder stick is made? Bubblegum and blackcurrant flavored mixes are separately processed and brought to a machine known as an extruder. The extruder twists and turns the mix and creates a continuous line of alternating swirls of flavor. This is cut into the right size and the ice cream stick is added at a later stage. After this, it is sent to a hardening tunnel. The thunder stick is wrapped and sent to cold storage. Did you know that ours is the only ice cream factory where all kulfis are made in fully automated machines? All ice creams are stored in giant cold rooms in the factory at minus 22 degrees. Each and every day, approximately 8 lakh cups, 10 lakh candies, 6 lakh cones, 1 ton of dry fruits, and 3 tons of liquid chocolate are processed in our factories. Our facility at Pundra is the largest fully automated plant in the country, which also adheres to the most stringent international standards of food and safety.
We have received an accreditation from the Export Council of India and also from the British Retail Consortium. This is giving us a lot of now a freedom to export our products. This is a very prestigious accreditation whereby it gives a lot of confidence in terms of quality and food safety for our products.
60% of our factory's land is allotted to tree plantation. Additionally, all the wastewater is sent to a treatment plant and is used for gardening and farming. Our plant at Bareilly is also a world-class facility that makes world-class ice creams. To keep up with ever-increasing demands, our in-house research and development team strives to create new and improved flavors, novelties and technologies each and every day. As a result, Vadilal has several firsts to its credit. We were the first to launch ice cream dollies, cones and sundaes in India. The first to get a fully automated candy manufacturing line. The first company in India to manufacture frozen desserts and much, much more. Each ice cream made at Vadilal goes through over 15 strict quality checks before dispatch. The packed ice creams are dispatched via special refrigerated vehicles sealed with a tamper-proof lock that are maintained at minus 20 degrees. These vehicles deliver the ice creams across the country.
Vadilal has the largest cold chain network in India. As on date, we have more than 50 stock points, 800 distributors and over 50,000 retailers. We ensure that our distributors get the delivery within 24 hours from the time of receiving orders.
And that's how you get your hands on your favorite ice cream. Vadilal has bagged 27 awards in 4 years and become the most trusted brand in the country.
We are proud to be the most awarded ice cream brand in the country by the Indian Dairy Association. We have been rated as one of the top 20 food brands in the country by Brand Equity Survey.
Vadilal today is much more than an ice cream brand and has diversified its interests. Established in 1991, Vadilal Quick Treat is today one of the largest processed food companies in India. At its plant in Dharampur in South Gujarat, fruits, vegetables and many other innovative foods and novelties are processed for the domestic and export markets. Yet another undertaking where Vadilal leverages its high quality standards is real estate. Vadilal Chemicals is a leading player in the business of industrial gases and chemicals since 1970. Vadilal Markets is the country's first and only foreign exchange, base metals and precious metals trading advisory company with ISO 9001:2008 certification. PowerSip is Vadilal's latest foray into the flavored milk category with an ever-increasing range of delicious flavors. Recently, Vadilal has ventured into the gelato segment with Meltin, India's first artisanal gelato brand. Today, that magical soda fountain of Sri Vadilal Gandhi has touched the lives of scores of people across the globe and put a smile on their face. Even after 100 years, Vadilal continues to bring delight with every bite. The one thing that has remained constant across the decades is the dedication, the commitment to make a real difference in the lives we touch. Vadilal Ice Cream.
You have seen the audiovisual, so you know the process. But to get at this stage is not easy. So first I would like to talk about the journey of Vadilal, how it started. Then I'll talk about the ice cream business, processed food, and the contemporary practices of the sales and marketing. Well, in 19, as you have already seen in the audiovisual, that in 1907, Vadilal started soda fountain, Vadilal soda fountain, where we were making fruits, all kind of snacks, along with that, we're serving ice cream also. But in those days, ice cream was a kind of, before it was born in India. So probably once or twice in a month we were making. And then we realized that demand for ice cream has increased, especially among the niche clients of Ahmedabad, Gujarat, because we were getting even orders from Surat, we were getting orders from Baroda. And the consumers were basically textile owners, because you know that in those days, Ahmedabad was a textile hub, and considered as Manchester, India. So we used to deliver ice cream on cycles, and maybe in the functions at the textile mills or at houses we used to deliver. Then, before we entered into the commercial way of making ice cream, we did number of businesses, and we are still continuing doing those businesses. We are into ice making business, cold storages, even trading of oil and trading of milk. And then we realized that there is a lot of potential in ice cream, and we are not able to cope with the demand. So somewhere in 1950s or 1960s, our parents decided to make ice cream on a commercial way. And in those days, import was not possible. So to make commercial way is to increase a traditional way of making ice cream. So we increased from sanchas to number of sanchas, and then again from, let's say, about 15-20 outlets we were serving in those days, we increased about 50-60. But then what is next? Making traditional way of ice cream will not serve the purpose, because the shelf life is a deterrent factor. So then again the idea was born, and we imported the modern technology. Even the modern technology in those days was attracting something for 300% import duty. So all the machines what we imported, we paid the tremendous amount, excess amount of duty, and we made a project report of 25 lakhs. So that was the turning point. In fact, the ice cream sector in those days was not considered as organized. The banks were not really ready to finance. There were no project reports. So my parents, they decided that let us when we are get bade hain to bhi aage karenge. So then that investment from 25 lakh, we started a plant of 600 kg a day. Today we are producing almost 250 tons of ice cream a day. So that was the breakthrough. In fact, to increase volumes was not difficult in those days. It was very difficult in those days. The reason when we started, we were cautioned by our well-wishers also that you are going in a wrong direction or you are going to the wrong industry, because the major deterrent factor is the electricity. In those days, the electricity was not there. Even in Ahmedabad also, there were power failures, a lot of electrical fluctuations. So how will you increase your volumes? Even the cabinets which are there on the retail counters, They were all imported. So, and that was again attracting 300% excise duty. Then again, we send our people abroad to learn the technology of cabinet making, even the transport, refrigerated transport also was not available. And no one was ready to invest into transport facility because the transport which is there is a specialized transport only for ice creams. So who will come and take that challenge? So we have no option but to invest ourselves. Then the phase came between that how to continue till we learn the technology. So we were transporting through shippers, insulated shippers, or maybe insulated vans. We imported panels, we fabricated them, easy. But again, in insulated panel, the challenge was there that we cannot transport ice cream beyond, let's say, 8 to 10 hours. So in those days, the road conditions were also not good. So we were able to reach only a part of Gujarat. After that, we convinced fertilizer company, that is IFFCO, that you make dry ice for us. It took a lot of time. Convince them, and they finally dry ice is made out of carbon dioxide. It's a byproduct of ammonia, and they accepted that, and they finally we were transporting through dry ice. But again, dry ice also has a limitation because it beyond 36 hours we cannot transport ice, and sometimes if there is a failure of truck, then the ice cream is damaged. So then again we imported the technology to make the trucks. We again entered into our own trucks. We till 1998 we were operating our own trucks, about 100 trucks. We started making our own cabinets. Even I know till in 1984 our one deep freezer, which was costing in those days 25,000 rupees, and today it is costing 18,000 rupees. So a lot of entry barriers are there in this line, lot of. Then phase of technology, then we are now today we are. So another challenge which we faced was a milk. Till 1995 we were procuring milk from the cooperatives, and suddenly the cooperative decided to enter into ice cream. And one fine day they stopped our supply. That's old cooperative practice, and thus they killed Paulson when they launched butter. And you were put in a very awkward situation. In 95, 96. Well, I don't know the name. I'll tell you later. So very bit awkward situation. We had no recourse but to go to a private dairy wala's, and again they were charging very high price, and then the consistent supply was not there. So what to do? So maybe we managed maybe a couple of months, and then we realized that we cannot continue with these guys. There is no but option but to go to the farmers. So we went to villages. We convinced the farmers to give the milk, because in those days the milk was also totally in the hands of cooperatives. Somehow we were able to manage the farmers. We created milk unions, the way the cooperatives operated, and we started with the collection of maybe in those days 10,000 liters of milk, and today we are collecting almost 5 lakh liters of milk from Gujarat and UP. We have put the bulk units, we have created milk unions over there, and we have got very good payment systems. We have
won the confidence level, because the most important, when you buy from farmers, when you buy from villagers, the confidence level from them is very important. Once they trust, they trust, but once they don't trust, they don't trust. And of course, out of this 5 lakh liters, we are during the flush season, we procure 5 lakh liters, and surplus milk we are giving to the co-op, I mean, dairy, all the dairies, private and cooperatives, to convert into powder and cream, and surplus we use it during the lean period. In fact, so we entered into processed food division. We are into canned, frozen food, as well as ready-to-eat Indian cuisine, Indian breads. We are exporting to almost 27 countries. In fact, all the plants are ISO certified BRC, and we have a very reputed accreditation from the Export Inspection Agency, which is one of the ice cream plants I'm talking about, which is a nodal agency promoted by the government as well as the National Dairy Development Board. And we have won the awards also. Well, talking about the processed food, as I mentioned, we are exporting to 27 countries. The challenges in this industry is even more than ice cream. Why? Because we are procuring fruits and vegetables from the farmers. Before 8 or 9 years, we faced a typical challenge because our consignments were getting rejected by the USFDA, by the EU. When we went to the agencies, they told us that the quality of fruits and vegetables in India is not acceptable as per our standard. So they must have improved the standard, or maybe because of the WTO agreement and those things, they have become more stringent. Oh, again, we were put into awkward situation what to do, because entire steak business was at stake. In those days, the contract farming was not that prevalent before 10 years. So we recruited agriculturalists. We took the advice from the universities, agriculture universities. We took the agriculturalists. We recruited them. We asked them to go into the market, to the farms, to teach them good agriculture practices. And they told us, sir, it is very difficult because farming activity in India is highly unorganized. Most of the farmers are using excess amount of insecticides, pesticides, chemicals, even fertilizers, and even they are using sometimes banned chemicals which are carcinogenic. And the consignments are getting rejected because these excess chemicals, they penetrate core of the fruits and vegetables. If it remains just only on the surface, then it can be definitely taken out by blanching and cleaning process. But if it has penetrated, then you can't. So taught them the good agriculture practices, and now we are procuring almost 70 to 80% of our fruits and vegetables through contract farming. And for that we have to even taken a huge land near our plants on lease, so that at least a soil can be protected. Well, ice cream and processed food both are freezing, again a freezing technology, again a defreezers, retail cabinets. So we have a huge strength of distributors, maybe 1,000 distributors and 70 stock points and more than 60,000 retailers in the market. We have about 10,000 FOWs, which you, I think recently you, are, you must be seeing in Ahmedabad also, but it is a common, very common trend to sell ice cream on lorries. That is very common trend in the north and the east. So we have about 10,000 freeze on wheels. We have a very very good integrated system. We are maintaining temperatures of each retailers, our stock points, our distributors. We are monitoring on the dashboards so that the cabinets that they maintain temperature at minus 18 degrees centigrade. We have about 300 mechanics running around the country just to repair these defreezers, and as soon as one defreezer is if it fails, then within 10 minutes we get our service division gets the SMS, and 8 to 16 hours our mechanic goes there and repairs it. So the dealer does not lose interest in selling freezing, and even does not get ice cream or processed food damaged in the cabinet. Well, talking about the marketing, well, as I already mentioned about our cold chain network, but again, the product branding strategy, which is most important, a very interesting research which we had before 10 years. We were about to expand our ice cream capacities. So before expansion, we had a research. So very interesting finding came out. After this research, they said that we have three options. One is take home category, one is the category which is for the kids, and the category for the impulse products, that is on the go buying. So research came that on the go buying segment is growing, but they do not like they would like to eat product with one hand. So I'm sure that if five or six guys, if you go out, you all whenever you take a pack of chips, there is you're always fighting who will hold that pack of chips, and you would like to share than holding.
Because using other hand for the phone.
That's right. In fact, so we entered. That's how the idea of Bada Bite and Flingo Cones came. So we, in fact, in the last after the research, we expanded capacity, and in last 8 years, we increased the volumes by 10 times in this specific impulse category. So my advice is that before you do any business, you do proper research. So friends, we are ice cream, like we are almost there in all the states of the country. We have been awarded, we have been recently introduced specific product categories of Bada Bite, Flingo for the impulse category, for the gourmet, for the take home category, and then which is contributing almost 30% to our sales. And we have been recently awarded by the Brand Trust Report that in India's most trusted brand ice cream category in 2013, and food and beverage sector in the World Brand Summit. So in fact, the journey through time has really been remarkable, and we are very proud to where we are today, and it is possible only through dedicated efforts, laborious efforts, And remember, success never comes easy. You have to work for it and you have to earn it. And with this, I wish all of you a success in your career, in your life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Your words were truly inspirational. The floor is now open to all questions from students. So I request you to please answer all the students' questions, please. Please, sir, you can come on stage.
Hello, sir. I had a simple question that how did the idea to make ice cream at that point of time came into your father's?
I don't know. 1907, I don't know. But in fact, see, well, what I can tell you is that see, it was like in 1907, those days ice cream was there in India, and one very old brand, maybe you don't know, which was there, Joy Ice Cream. You must remember. It's a very old brand, and somehow the idea clicked from Joy and we started.
Sir, I remember then that when I was a child and when I would go out with my father and when I would ask for ice cream, my father would categorically ask whether it's Vadilal or any other brand. He had that trust. While when I do the same thing and I go out with my friends, I do not find that categorical question. And somewhere, we also find that somewhere Havmor has done the beating. So, what do you think about that?
Yeah, okay. In fact, they are into restaurant category. And restaurant category has, in Ahmedabad, has some added advantage. Whereas if you go out of Ahmedabad, that's not the case.
Sir, how does this of a particular product plays a role in such industry, because it's now becoming more competitive?
In fact, I have not shared one example. Maybe 2 minutes. Price is very important, absolutely important. When we started in 1972, commercial way of making ice cream, we launched a cup and candy at 20 paisa. And today, to get the volumes, we have highly penetrated Indian rural segment, and especially they require 5 rupee and 10 rupee cup. In fact, for the last 16 years, we are selling a cup at 5 rupee.
What have you done to maintain the price at 5 rupees for an SKU?
See, most of, not only ice cream category, most of them, if you go to any brand, they have reduced the pack size. But then, to manage a 5 rupee, even Parle Ji also, they have been maintaining that price segment. And very high rural marketing Parle Ji has.
Question.
I would love to know of the idea that was behind Melvin as the concept.
Okay.
See, it's again a gelato product. It is kind of a idea came that let's give something new to the Ahmedabad, and the idea came. In fact, if you go to Italy and European countries, especially Italy, the gelato is being sold in much higher volumes than ice creams. It is little bit heavy ice cream, and with fresh fruits flavors. They call that they are in gelato. In fact, there are three categories of flavors: one synthetic, natural, and then natural. So in gelato, we use natural flavors.
Biggest failure, and how did you overcome that?
Biggest
failure.
Oh, I already shared. So, it was not a failure, but it was a challenge. Well, we failed many areas. Like in businesses also, we failed, and then we thought that food is our business. So let us stick to food.
Everybody else who would like to ask more questions, please feel free to mail Keshav sir the questions. We will definitely get back to you. We have a little news. Mr. Gandhi will not be able to join us for the rest of the evening due to some other prior commitments. So I request the audience to, of course, please give him a huge round of applause. And also please accept for our appreciation for you being here today.
Mr. Gandhi, sir, thank you for encapsulating 109 years of Wadilal's journey in your candid talk. Your talk very beautifully highlighted time and again the importance of trust in business. And for the young students here, I'm sure they now realize why it is so important for us to pay attention on research before we start executing an idea. And on behalf of all the students and the faculty members here, we are very appreciative of you taking all the questions so humbly. Thank you so much, sir.
As our second speaker today, we have with us Mr. Sameer Sinha. Mr. Sinha is the Managing Director at Savvy Infrastructures Private Limited. Savvy today has established a formidable reputation in the real estate arena in Gujarat. Savvy has built projects worth nearly Rs. 1,200 crores, including 200 million square feet of residential and commercial development and 800 acres of golf township since 1996. He pursued his BS in civil engineering with concentration in geotechnology and foundation engineering from Gujarat University, and MS in civil engineering, specializing in construction engineering and management from Purdue University, USA. He is also the Managing Director of Kensville Golf Community and the Chairman of Indian Green Building Council, Ahmedabad. We welcome you on stage, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, ma'am, respected faculty. First of all, thank you so much. It's indeed a pleasure and a privilege and an honor to be here with you. Very exciting always to come back to campuses. My entire existence actually started from not far from here, Engineering College, just down the road. and like in this one right now, yeah. So that's what I was going to start with, that we are all stories in the end. At the end of our journey, what we will be a story. And I think when you were talking about it, that's exactly what you said, that the story, if it is going to be a story, it better be a good one. That we should at least have the passion and the diligence to make it a good story. I think you've gone through now almost 2 days of this, right? So it's still good to see that all of you are still here. Is it compulsory to be here? Is it part of the course? Or is it optional? I don't think so. I don't believe you. I think you're saying that because the staff is still sitting here and the people are here. Yeah. I can see some nodding here. So I think you're here because you all feel it is compulsory and you probably affect your grades or your scores. But so let me tell you this. I will not bore you with technical details anymore. I think you've heard enough of it. You all know now how to become an entrepreneur and be successful, right? So you don't want to know about... I'll tell you a few stories about myself. Hopefully you learn something from it. And I'll be more than happy to answer any questions you have. So like I said, we are all stories. So let me start with my story. Like I said, Indian Engineering College, very important for me because that's where it all started. First day of college, I was actually 2 weeks late in school for some reason. And so by the time I went to my first class in first semester, I didn't know anybody. Everybody had already started classes. And I was the new kid on the block. I had no idea where to go, what to find. So I barely found my orientation and my civil engineering class. And I walked in. And this guy comes up to me and says, you know, I can see you've not been here before. You know, there have been 4 lectures of maths. And if you need any notes, I'd be more than happy to help you. I said, why is he doing this to me? Why is he being so nice to me? I realized he was running for elections. He was going to be the next CR. And he wanted all the votes he could get. But that connect, and I think some of you guys know who I'm talking about, but that connect, that first chance encounter, established a relationship that exists today. And what also happened was when we turned out to have, his roll number was right next to mine, and we're 3 friends who have roll number next to each other, and we are still business partners today. And the reason for that is that we did some collaborative learning in exams too, I think. And by virtue of that, I think we have a compulsion to work together because we only know 1/3 of everything. You should not be clapping about this, okay? This is not a good lesson to learn. Don't make notes of this. No, but what I'm trying to say is life will give you opportunities. You've got to grab it. Life is all about chance encounters, but you will need a lot more to become successful. First thing you'll need is acumen, which I guess all of you already have because you're here. You've already cleared what you need to clear to get to this point. So you have the intelligence, you have the emotional capability, you have the smartness, you have the acumen to do this. And acumen will obviously depend on your education, it'll depend on your upbringing, it'll depend on your cultural background, depend on everything that you have, but the summary of everything that you have today is what you are left with, is your intelligence. What you also need is opportunity. But that is not really in your hand, right? You'll get opportunity as you get along. But God only favors the brave. So you have to take the risk, you have to take the chance that you get. But you also have to have the intelligence to recognize the opportunity that you get. So that's where your education comes in handy. And beyond then, you need hard work. No shortcuts, no shortcuts to hard work, we all know that. And you do these 3 things well, and you will succeed. That's a guarantee. You have to do these 3 things. Of course, you get the opportunity, recognize it, work hard at it, and you will succeed. But you know what is the toughest thing beyond success? Let me ask you a question before I get to this. So where do you guys, what is the purpose of your doing this? Why are you here in class, or actually where do you want to, what do you want to do in life? Feel free, answer whatever comes to your mind. Anybody? Come on, somebody's got to answer. Yes, please.
A world-class investor.
Investor, wonderful. Anybody else? And why do you want to be an investor?
Because I want I want to make a lot of money. And then
wonderful answer, wonderful answer. Exactly what I was looking for. Anybody else? Yes.
To be successful in any means.
And success means what?
In any context, like.
No, what would be successful to you? Success to you? Money would be success, fame would be success. What would be success?
Living my life which I want.
Wonderful, good. Freedom. Come on, one more. A girl, please, somebody. All you girls here. Come on, speak up. What would be the purpose of your life? Why are you working so hard? Yes. And you need money for that. So you want money. You want money, he wants freedom, you want money. You think when Vadilal Gandhi started his business to make ice cream with that thing, he was thinking about money? Do you think so? I don't think he was thinking about money. So don't start your business with money at the end of it. Start your business because you have something that you haven't heard about. You have this success. That is the key, my friend. That is exactly what Vadilal Gandhi had. The passion to make ice cream, that was what gave him joy. That is the key to success. Only passion will bring you success. How do you sustain passion? Very simple. And that's all I want to talk to you about. If you have this formula right, it's a cycle of good fortune. You can travel all you want. You can make all the money and we have all the freedom you want. You can make all the money you want. I'm not saying making money is wrong. I'm saying, is that what gives you happiness? Do it. If social work gives you happiness, do that. But don't chase the wrong target. Chase happiness, chase joy. That's exactly what will, at the end of it, will give you real, true happiness. It's a philosophical discussion. We can go on and on about this. But let me tell you two or three tricks that I at least practice, and which, because it's very difficult to sustain passion. Passion is a good word to say. Now imagine you've started a business, you've done well, you've sold off the business, now what? You made all the money you wanted, your startup did well. You have to reignite that passion, go chase another target, redo the whole thing all over again, right? It's not easy to sustain that. And to sustain passion, you have to keep seeking new areas to motivate yourself, to find happiness, to seek joy in that. But the one thing that I have found, at least from my own experience, is that you cannot be passionate about anything unless you are real. Because the amount of energy you spend in camouflaging who you are, in trying to protect your true identity, in trying to fake your true self, is so much that it takes away all your energy that you'd have spent into being truly creatively real. So don't be fake. Other trick I have is find a mentor. At this young age, go find one mentor who will give you true, unbiased advice. It could be a friend, it could be a parent, it could be any. But as far as you can, find somebody who's unbiased. Usually parents are very biased. So find somebody outside your comfort zone. Find somebody who will give you genuine, true, good advice, because you need to vet your ideas. They may or may not always work, but there is no bad idea. But at least find a mentor who will do that. Every time you feel bored, every time you feel like you're not doing enough or the idea is not working, get out of your comfort zone, try something else. But stick to something till you get there. Like a postage stamp. You need to stick to that envelope till you get to the address. Don't give up. Stick to it till you get there. Once you get there, you do something else, that's fine. But get there, like a postage stamp, very important to remember. Feed your soul. I think this sounds very philosophical to all of you, right? You understand what I'm saying? It is very important to keep rejuvenating yourself. If business rejuvenates you, keep doing more of it. If reading rejuvenates you, keep doing that. But every once in a while, come back and remember who you are and what motivates you, what gives you energy, what gives you joy, and do that. So keep feeding that. Don't forget your own true identity. I'll tell you one more story. In the 7th standard, you'll know, at least my two colleagues here will remember Betty Fernandez. She used to be a teacher, and when I was in 7th standard, we all went to the same school. And she used to teach us English. And they used to make us write essays.
everything was handwritten in those days. It was not electronic like you guys have. And there was no multiple choice questions, no online exams, everything was on paper. So she made us write essays. And every time, and then in the class, my essay would be incomplete. Every time. All of sixth standard and almost half of seventh standard, my essays would always be incomplete. And there was this one Diwali vacation in seventh standard. And that Diwali vacation, Diwali was on the day of my birthday. And I was very happy about it. And I came back from Diwali vacation. Obviously, the first thing that she does is say, write an essay on Diwali vacation. So I wrote an essay on Diwali vacation. The essays were turned in. I managed to complete my essay. Next Monday, in class, she comes out to class and she's barely ever noticed me in all these years. Definitely not a favorite student. And she comes out to class and she says, I have a wonderful essay that somebody's written and I want to read that essay out. And she starts reading the essay. And I, as usual, am not paying attention in class, doing something, doodling. Halfway through the essay, I realize she's reading my essay. And at the end of it, she said, A. She never you would give an A. Betty Fernandez would not give an A. She gave an A and the essay. And actually, she didn't even know who I was, so she's given A and said, that wonderful essay, and she left it. But I treasured that feeling. And I made it a point that I want to store that feeling of achieving that A in something that I thought I could never do for the rest of my life. That's what motivates me even today. Every time that I feel I'm not doing well, I'm not happy about doing something, I want to go back and generate that sentiment again in myself to rejuvenate it. Remember that one little success that you had. There are no big successes. When I'm telling you, I'm almost 50 and I'm still telling you stories from 7th standard. Imagine the impact these things have in life. It is not about the money I've made. It's not about the success at work. These are the kind of things that will motivate you. You'll remember your teacher, you'll remember your little incidents, you'll remember the picnics you've had, you remember the vacations you've taken. If these are the things that will give you happiness, why worry about the big stuff? But find motivation in these. So treasure that feeling. There is a... Anytime you guys are getting bored, please let me know, I'll end it. This is something that I want to... Whatever. I want to read out to you guys. Passion Lives Here is the full poetry. I just read out a few sentences from it. And this is very relevant for all of you who want to be entrepreneurs. Heart is what drives us and determines our fate. Mavericks, dissidents, adventurers, outsiders, rebels, people who ask questions. Evidently, not all of you are. So people who ask questions, people who bend the rules, people who take risks are the people who will lead the world. Nice people with common sense will end up working for them. So you have to decide what you want to be. Are you going to be the maverick and the rebel? Are you going to bend the rules? Or will you follow the straight line and be the nice and have a lot of common sense? So entrepreneurship is not for everybody. It's definitely not for everybody. You need to be extremely brave. It is a merciless profession. So if you are really not that brave and not that interested in putting yourself through continuous pain in life, seek the easy option. Go get a job, nice, cushy, plush job, make lots of money. What's wrong with that? But entrepreneurship is not going to be easy. But very simple formula, everybody's talked about it. I'm sure yesterday Kaushal and Bayram and everybody said this, and I'm not going to repeat it, but it's essentially this, right? You need an idea, you need energy, and passion I already expressed, talked to you about. Correct? Not correct. What you need is this. You need disruptive idea. You don't need a normal idea. You need an idea that is going to change the world. At least you have to believe it. You need demonic energy. You don't want normal energy. Unless that you get consumed by that idea, unless you are willing to give up everything you have for that idea, unless you're willing to motivate, to invest everything, all your day's energy into that, that's what demonic energy is. That's what you need. And then you need undying passion. So I lived 7 years in the US. From after I graduated college, that was telling you, wealthy gave me a lot, so it also gave me my wife. Another story which I can go on forever, but I'll not get into that. But both of us went to school in the US, grad school, and for till 7 years we lived in the US, very happy. And then the entrepreneur in me woke up again and decided to come back. Gave up everything I had. Very nice, cushy job, good money. We were in this category called dinks, double income, no kids. So we were very happy dinks in the US, and we moved back. And then I partnered with these two friends that I had collaborative learning with, and we started in 1995. That's when we did this. So that is when I told my wife that when I'm coming back today, you'll have to give me 3 years when you move back to India. And for 3 years, my son was just born when we had moved back, my elder son. I said, 3 years, don't expect anything from me, because I am going to consume myself with my work. You'll have to put up with me for 3 years. If I don't succeed in 3 years, you have that job to go back to. I had a plan. I'll go back, I knew which airport I would land at. I knew which car dealership to go to. I had the Jeep Grand Cherokee I had lined up. I knew the color of the car. I knew the house I would go into. That backup plan I had. But I said, for the 3 years, I'm not going to think about that. And for the 3 years, I'm going to only think about what I want to do here. And I'm not going to be home. So I think for those 3 years, I was totally consumed. And I don't think my wife saw much of me till midnight. My son didn't see much of me. But they were nice enough to put up with me. But that is the kind of demonic energy and passion I'm talking about. Everybody has said about, yesterday I think I was reading in the paper, that I think Behram mentioned eternal optimism. Let me tell you about the story of failure. And somebody talked about failure right now, right? I think failure is extremely, extremely important. But the trick to failure is that you have to, just like you treasure that Betty Fernandez incident, you have to treasure failure. And you treasure failure in a way that you don't want to ever go back to that situation. It has to keep you awake at night worrying about that situation. And that is the only way to prevent failure. Failure is very important. It will teach you lessons like nothing else does. Mike Tyson says, everybody has a plan till you get hit in the face. When you get hit in the face, all your plans go out of the window. And you had a plan, it was working, and then suddenly something hits you in the face. There's actually companies in the Bay Area which, so for example, if Apple has 10 projects that they will fund every year, they will look at the end of the year, the worst performing projects, the biggest failures. And historically, they will look at who are in these teams, that the project that have failed. And they will pick 5 people from the worst performing, worst failures, and fund them. Because they are the people who will fail yet not give up. That is the key to an entrepreneur. That you just can't afford to give up. Fail, of course you will fail. But treasure that failure and convert it into your energy to do better, to do more. So eternal optimism. And like I said, constant pursuit of joy. If you have these two things, I think you're set. That's it. That my slideshow is over. There's one more poetry that I can read if you're interested, or else we can just end this, and this is a good point to end, I think, and we can answer some questions. You guys don't give up, which I like. Okay. On a slightly more philosophical note, let me read this poetry. It is extremely, I love it, because every time I think it's very relevant for you guys. It's by a poet called Pablo Neruda. It says, you start dying slowly. You start dying slowly when you kill your self-esteem. You start dying slowly when you do not let others help you. You start dying slowly if you become a slave to your habits, walking every day on the same path, if you do not change your routine, if you do not wear different colors, or if you do not speak to those you don't know. You start dying slowly if you avoid to feel passion and its turbulent emotions, those that make your eyes glisten and your heart beat fast. You start dying slowly if you do not change your life, when you're not satisfied with your job or with your love or whatever, if you do not risk what is safe for the uncertain, if you do not go after a dream, if you do not allow yourself at least once in your lifetime to run away from sensible advice that your parents and your teachers and people like me keep giving you. Don't listen to us. Do what you have to do. Thank you so much.
The floor is open for questions.
Good evening. So I have a question. In my faculty says, my friend says that you have to make a product that customer wants. In starting, we do a market research and we find out the product that the customer wants. But when we go out in the market after building the product, that the customer doesn't want it because the customer trends are changing and they are innovating with the needs. So how to constantly innovate your product according to the customer?
You don't innovate it according to the customer. You do what you feel the customer wants, not what the customer says. Do you think you wanted the iPhone? We were very happy with, what was that little thing that used to play music?
iPod.
Right? We didn't want the iPhone, the iPod to be part of the iPhone. We didn't want, Steve Jobs is a perfect example of, you say, you know, you give them cake, they'll eat cake. You give them bread, they'll eat bread. But you have to know what to give them. So I'll give you an example. So I didn't talk about my company because I think we were going too much into, please sit down. We were going too much into details. But when we first started our company in 1995, 96, the first project we launched was called the building called Chapath 1, which is on SG Highway. A lot of you might know, Bodhanthal is the address. Shameful that everybody knows Bodhanthal. But anyway, that's the tragedy of our business. But, so that building, when we first started building that, at the inauguration, we do this Kath Murat and, you know, people come and there was this very prominent builder, which I don't want to name today. And he said, Catherine Chopra, who's going to come here? This is the first commercial building on SG Highway. This is the year is 1995. A lot of you probably were not even born then already. So, the first commercial building on SG Highway used to be a jungle, practically. And there was only a couple of projects, which were all residential apartment complexes were there on SG Highway in those days. This was the first commercial building. And he said, you should change it. This is a commercial building. People still have, in those days, in our brochure we had written, in 1996, that in the 80s, in the 70s, there was a relief road. In the 80s, there was Ashram Road. In the 90s, there was CG Road. And in 2000, there will be SG Road. This was written, and we used to practically happy after the brochure of another idea of Yamanama. So this was done by us in the year 1995. And if nobody believed that there would be a commercial building on that road. But we were a little ahead of time. But in 2 years, that was the most successful building in SGI. And after that, you see NetLab, nobody. And this gentleman who gave us this advice, who was a very prominent, very established, 30 years experience, he converted one of his residential buildings immediately after our building into a commercial. So you can't always rely on research. Research is good, but you have to go with gut. And you have to kind of buck the trend. You can't always follow the trend, otherwise you'll never be a leader. And take risk.
Thank you, sir. Sir, you said that we at times should not listen to what adults say.
I'm sorry, what?
We at times should not listen to what adults say.
No, I didn't say adults. I said, sometimes break away from sensible advice. Don't do the most sensible, boring, regular thing.
That's
so
what
go home and tell your dad I told you to do it.
The problem is, I am right now in a couple of situations like that.
Who is it?
It involves taking business decisions and keeping in mind what the family wants. Well, if I end up doing what I want,
where my orthodox family, if I may use the word.
Is the family funding you?
It is.
Then you got to what they say.
No, the problem is, sir, in the long term, they are my progeny. I don't know what to do, whether I should be keeping, I should be looking after my selfless.
Okay, I didn't realize this was going to be a spiritual discussion, but let me go. If there is something more important than anything else in this world, it's family. If you have to sacrifice everything, obviously you're not married. Today, no, I'll tell you, very interesting, when I fell in love with my wife, if somebody said, you know, that feeling of first love, but if that, in those days, somebody said, you know, I'll drop her off the building unless you kill yourself or whatever. I said, yeah, sure, I'll kill myself. No, I will not do that. Right? But today, if somebody dangles my son off a building and he says, I'll drop him unless you kill yourself, I will kill myself. Right? That's the difference. That's why family is important. Family, you can't exist without a family. But yeah, of course, find balance. If the family is inhibiting you, you have to find your own, fight your battles. Go ahead, I can hear you.
So, as you said that passion, you need to follow your passion to be a successful entrepreneur or probably to make money. But sometimes passion is such that in that way or in that journey, we can never earn money.
Good question, but you misunderstood what I said. I did not say follow your passion to make money. I said follow your passion to be happy. Big difference. If money gives you happiness, you'll have money. But if money does not give you happiness and something else does, follow your passion to do that. At the end of it, think about it. I am 50 years old. I have good 20, 30 years ahead of me. Right? What do you think my pursuit should be? To be happy or to make more and more money? If you are getting that knowledge today, you will get 40 years of more good happiness instead of my 20 years of happiness. So follow your route and find happiness. But yes, it's all good and nice to say. You will need some amount of money to even do your basic happiness. So, that's how come I love it. You have to be a pragmatist also. You have to be practical. I think I've taken up enough time. Thank you so much. Yes, please, last question. I'm okay, but I don't want to keep asking you.
So you talked about having a mentor.
Yes.
So could you please talk about your mentor and how you identify
that? Yes, definitely. So I have been blessed. First of all, because I have these, we are three partners at work, and we are tremendous. We have this, like, it's our own internal board of advisors that we have. So that works very well for us. But besides that, you always need to have somebody outside. So my mentor has been my elder brother, and we've had a very business like relationship when it comes to talking about things. It can be family, it can be anybody, but yes, I think you always need to have one source which can give you unbiased advice. Thank you so much. Pleasure.
The next speaker this evening is Mr. Rajiv Patel. He is the trustee and founder of the Foundation City Heritage Center. He is the partner in XL Group of Companies, a real estate enterprise, and the owner of the French Haveli, co-owner of the Divanjini Haveli. He pursued his education, his bachelor's in engineering, civil engineering from MS University, Baroda. He has pursued several other short professional courses in management, HR, land, revenue, sales, marketing from local institutes. He calls himself a real estate developer and has also done several projects in the old city of Ahmedabad. We welcome you, sir. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Sam, it was wonderful to hear you.
Thank you, sir.
Everybody agrees?
Yes.
I wish my son was here. Anyway, so I'm Rajiv Patel, as everybody introduced me. And whatever Sam said about passion and whatever he said, at 48, I think I'm at the right track. Thank you for that. Yeah. And so when I was called over here, so I'm doing something in the Old City which I'm going to talk to you about. Recently, how many of you have heard that Ahmedabad's heritage and World Heritage City and all those things, anybody knows about what's going on? Can you raise your hand? You don't know. Okay, how many of you have been to the Old City of Ahmedabad? Oh, lot many. How many knows the word called heritage? And I believe some of you are having some module in heritage management?
Yes.
Excellent. How many of you? Oh, quite many. Great. So I know what I'm talking about. Alright, so like Samir said, that it better be a good story. So, I've been 8 years doing this and still I'm answering a lot of questions. Till last year I was answering my wife, what the hell are you doing? She gave me a nice challenge, you know, positive challenge, that if you don't achieve this, then you better leave heritage. Yes, heritage ko chhod do abhi. So I fulfilled that challenge and now today she is with me. In fact, she wanted to come and listen. Tum kya baat karte ho, mujhe sunna hai. So the topic is making heritage profitable, and the approach is of a social enterprise. Anybody knows what is a social enterprise? Hello? Anybody knows what is a social enterprise? Just raise your hands. I don't need to ask you. Just raise your hands. Okay, only 1%, 2%, 3%. Okay, great. So Chetan Bhagat recently said that most of us Gujjus or Indians are very good at making your life predictable. You know, like when I was just in college and coming out, so the simple formulas: go out, make your crores, and then get married, have kids, be happy. Nobody wants to experiment with their life, and when I'm in this heritage field, every day I'm meeting young people and people who are just having a small idea. You know, I met one girl, and she was backpacking in India way in 2003, and now she is back here doing a textile business, meeting farmers in villages and buying organic cotton, and she is having a business in Chicago. So I have been doing something like this, which is literally people have called me crazy, especially my friends and my partners. So, but at the end of 8 years, I'm seeing something, but still I'm halfway. Like I'm Vadilan. So when I got a call, I was actually sweeping the floors in Old City. Joking, but that's the state of things. That's the state of things of heritage in India. Okay. So just to tell the story, so this is what we have been doing. And one day in 2007, I was asked a question by our architect Kamal Mangaldas, that have you done the heritage walk? Or he asked a precise thing, that if you're thinking so creatively, why don't you do something in the Old City? And I'm very enthusiastic and I say yes to most of the things. So the next day we are doing the heritage walk, and to cut the story short, we ended up buying one Haveli. And this is a 250-year-old property, one of the very good properties of Ahmedabad. So I'm going to just take you through some slides so you know what's happening in the Old City of Ahmedabad, right? So you'll just see some photographs of a Haveli and how a Haveli is restored. So this is the old Ahmedabad, 600-year-old city. We had a lot of wooden Havelis and many have come down. Okay. How many of you have been to a European city? Okay. So when we go to the European city, we go to the old town, right? So we are awestruck, our jaws are dropping, because the beauties of the old city. The new cities are exactly same what we have. We have golf courses and we have super express highways and malls, right? So something happened to us also similarly in 2009 when we went to south of France. I saw Nice, south of France, and I just was there and staring. I said, "Apnu sankri sheri out che." And I was telling my friend, "It's just more clean. The signages are nice, and it's more organized." You know. So coming back to this, so this is a typical haveli, and the havelis are generally damaged because of lack of maintenance. So I'm going to talk to you about the story about that lot of money is being made in India in the last 20 years. Everybody agrees? We never heard before 20 years that Indian companies could go and buy companies in Australia, right? So there is a lot of money. Lot of people traveled in the last 20 years, right? So a lot of change is happening. So there is a thing called old city revitalization. See, if somebody comes from America or anybody, what would you want them to see about your city? Hello? The old city, right? Because that's different, it's unique. So the way each person is unique, each city is unique because it has a cultural heritage in the old city, the character, and there is a whole story of how many people ruled. You know, there is a whole story, and the building forms change, and there are two kinds of culture, the tangible and the intangible, like the people, the way they live, how they talk, how they eat, and the buildings, right? So what we are talking about is that as we grow our city, as a lot of money is getting invested, but in developing countries like India, because of the whatever systems, there is no policy for or any organized way of dealing with our old cities, and we are losing our identity. So imagine after 20 years, we have so much of new city investments and, you know, everything, and no heritage. What would be the city like? So in the European or developed world, lot of work has happened in the old cities. I'll show you slides where the European cities went through the same thing after the World War II, and today they have saved their old cities. Okay, so this is just a typical slide of how this property was. Can you see the damage? So now, would anybody buy this property? Question is, what to do with this property? Right? So I have a reputation of doing crazy things and following my heart. And I have three partners, like us, we are four, so we have three other partners who are very sensible and very logical. And they keep me at bay. They keep me away when there have to be sound financial decisions to be taken. So I came up with this idea that why don't we buy this property. I had met Mr. Debashish Naik of Ahmedabad University, who is now running the, and he had sold me an idea that there should be a heritage center in the old city of Ahmedabad. So my other smart partners thought that this is a good investment because the cost of the property is much less than the cost of the wood over there. So it's a good decision. You know, we are just getting this property with, of course, there are six tenants, but 40 lakh rupees, and my partners thought, ke bhi chalo, Rajiv ko de do, 2 saal he'll play with this, and he'll not disturb us, you know. Because I had to unleash my creativity and do something different. Right, so, but Devashish was very smart, you know. He didn't tell us that the restoration amount is going to be 6 times than the cost of the land. So anyway, the story goes like this, that you do something because, you know, you listen to your heart and you don't know, you don't have a business plan. And I used to meet, then, you know, suddenly I started hearing new words, adaptive reuse. And Abhay said, what's your business plan? I said, hum builder ne toh kabhi business plan banaya nahi. We bought the land and the land price went up, so business became viable. See, because of what I'm doing, now I meet a lot of experts and scholars and, you know, PhDs. And I said, I'm just a BE civil, and half the time I was bunking classes. But still, I'm called to various seminars because as an entrepreneur, whatever is written in the book, without knowing that, I implemented in the field. So that's what being an entrepreneur is, that you are vulnerable, you are ready to take risk and you are not scared of failing. You know, thai padse, that's what Vadilal said, right? So what happened is that we started, my journey to this whole domain started, and because the six tenants were to be dealt with, every day I would go to the old city in the rickshaw. Before, I had never gone to the old city. In fact, after coming to this field, I went and saw my father's old city house. So that was the story. So we started doing the restoration. Two, three things happened, which are, now I'm going to just talk about two, three important decisions and turning points. One is that for 2 years, we didn't know what to do with it. So we're just sitting there. In 2009, I went to Spain. And in Spain, I saw a cultural center. And Devashish was telling me what a cultural center is. I had no idea what is a cultural center. But I went to Spain and I saw a cultural center. And then I exactly knew what a cultural center is. That it was a beautiful building in north of Madrid. There are some photographs which will come in the slide. And it's named Casa de la India. It's a center about India. And I had never seen so many books about India before when I went to that center in Spain. And there are musical instruments about India, and everybody's talking about India. And so that was a beautiful center, and how culture is used to run a center. So I knew now something. The other thing which happened was that I met a restoration company, and he took me around to various restoration sites. And also the good thing was that he was doing modern construction, so he took me to some of his projects. So I started believing. So one of the other important thing of an entrepreneurship is to get your belief, to move out and to meet a lot of people. So there is a value of getting exposure. So if you're just meeting your four friends and then having great plans, nothing is going to change in your life. So it's very important that you go out and you experiment. In fact, somebody has written that spend all your money in traveling. You know, I mean, not expensive traveling, basic traveling, but take exposure. So I came back home and I called my partners. I was very excited. And for the first time, I did a PowerPoint presentation. Because as a builder, I never had to do a PowerPoint presentation. So I got four slides together. I called my partners home. I called Debashish, his wife Indu, and Rakesh, Rupesh, Pravesh. And I was showing them that this is what is possible in this property. And they're laughing, you know, secretly. But anyway, I was like, because seeing is believing, right? See, you have a thing called your subconscious mind, and you get things going in your mind, and then you get a conviction. You start operating from your guts, right? That something is, and you don't know how, but it's going to happen. So that kind of things happen. So this is one step. The other thing happened was in 2010 monsoon, I went to this property and it was raining heavily. And by that time, we were just trying, you know, thoda try karte the. I was called Devashish, kya karna hai, all those things. But we found out that actually there were no workers. There were nobody who was wanting to do this. So in 2010 monsoon, I went there and I realized that in 3 years, this property has gone down 50% more. So that day I took a decision that I have to do something. So that was the turning point that I took a decision. So remember in life that anything will start happening in your life once you take a decision. So success is equal to decision making, right? And decision is in your hands. So we just move fast forward and we started restoring this property. And we went to various restoration exhibitions also. We used very good techniques. And slowly, things started moving and we got a team together. Media started writing about it. My partners got confident. And that 6 times money got invested, slowly. And amazing network started happening. So this is what the property looks like today. These are the rooms. Okay, so we have made a complete center with 3 rooms. This is a ballroom. Bedrooms, okay. Corporate art gallery. So this is how the property is. But what next? See, the question was that during this process, there were a lot of things which happened. One was that each time we kept on making the investment, I started understanding that we need to have a business plan. Kuch to karna padega. So now the other thing which I want to tell you about is that world over there is a group of heritage buildings being restored, which is called precinct development. See, right now if 3-4 buildings are there, nothing is going to happen. So this is a sketch which an American girl has made. Just see what's happening over here. right? So this is called a precinct. So in heritage management, if you want more and more things to happen, then you need to have a group and clusters of houses. So that's a plan which has to happen. So by this time we started understanding what is old city and what kind of investment should happen. And this is an example of Amsterdam. After the World War II, the Amsterdam city was bombed like this. And it was like really bad shape, and even what was happening right now, the roads are expanding, pulling down heritage buildings. Same thing happened, and people got together and they decided to make a business plan and to save the heritage. So a complete street development. See, what needs to happen in Ahmedabad is not just 3-4 buildings, but complete street development, which is called a precinct, and a whole place to go, right, where you could actually go there. And so that's the next step. So this is the Amsterdam city, and over here in the center is the World Heritage Site. So Ahmedabad has been trying to get itself accepted to be a World Heritage City. Now what is a World Heritage City? UNESCO has a category of World Heritage Site and a World Heritage City. So in India, there is not a single World Heritage City. So imagine what can happen that if Ahmedabad gains this title of being a World Heritage City. I'll just show you what is happening across the world. This is the city of Sao Paulo in Latin America. And their old city is as big as Ahmedabad's old city, 5 square kilometers. But they are doing billions of dollars of business every day. So they have made the old city into powerhouse, economic powerhouse. So that is what is possible in Ahmedabad's old city. Also, old city is a tremendous cultural value. Like people want to go and live in Manhattan because of the various cultural experiences. So old city has that power. So if a city wants to attract investment, a restored old city could be a tremendous brand value. Okay, so this is a possibility. Now if you see the cities of the world like Nice, you know, Ahmedabad has a lot of potential because it's similar. Yeah, and this is the map of Ahmedabad, and there you see the Ahmedabad old city in the center. So point is that now what we need to take it to the next level. So as a group, as a single person, we have invested in 3 properties and going ahead. But now how to make this thing go to the next level? We have 2,000 listed buildings. And if you see, our city is investing heavily into infrastructure. For example, the riverfront project is 1,500 crores. Right? Imagine the old city being restored like Amsterdam. It would just cost maybe 50 crores or 100 crores. But the value of that could be much, much bigger because it creates a brand. Because the old city is always going to be the soul. And look at what Amsterdam is doing. They have made a branding called I Amsterdam. So that is all possible. Okay, now one more thing which I want to talk about is what other decisions I made. So once we kind of started finishing this building, and it is our own asset, to put money in the asset and it is appreciating was a very logical step, because we bought it at X price and after 5 years, 10 years, it's going to be like 10x, so no problem, let's put money in it. But what to do about the use plan? So this was a very important decision which I made. This is the cultural center which I was talking about, and then we thought that this is what we could have, a conference, and we did various things, like we had a piano recital and various things we experimented, so we knew that this is all possible. This is the restoration exhibitions. So by this time I was understanding that there need to be an economic model. So I was asking Debash, is that now my restoration is getting over, and in 3 months I'm going to go back to my SG Highway office, and the momentum and the stake which I'm putting as an individual is going to be cut off. So if I go back, then I'm never going to come back. So aapko mujhse jo kaam karwana hai karwa lo old city, you know, because everybody's on it. So I said, what is the economic model? So a mail came to him, and this is the economic model of Amsterdam. This is a mutual fund which they created in the 1950s. This fund today has 500 properties, and they're paying off 5% dividend to the fund holders, but the model is rental. See, in the European cities, to stay in the old city is a premium. That's not possible in India. So I was just looking at various things, but by this time I was getting engrossed in this. I was getting deeply into it. Like what Samir was saying about being successful, one of the ingredients is that you have to really immerse yourself into something. Like din raat main ek hi cheez karta tha, I was trying to find the answers, you know. Still I have not met with all the answers. Then I met with the another model, which is ICICI, Michael Porter, if people are learning, like, I never knew Michael Porter, but I started reading about strategy and everything. So Michael Porter is an NGO in the American Old Cities. So a lot of knowledge started gathering to me and I started understanding the old city process. So now I'm sitting with this Haveli with an investment of 3 crore rupees and I'm responsible for this investment. So I'm just looking that if I can make a 10% return, then it will be a very good thing. I can give a good answer to my partners that okay, now this is a good return on investment, it's a good property. But what I realized that sitting in a city, because what was happening is that in the 5 years where I was there, so many buildings were being pulled down. Illegal work is happening. You know, heritage properties are being sold left and right. Local politicians are doing things. So I said, Marasiyo ko gaando chhet niya share mo. I am the only person who is restoring a property. Nobody is interested. That means, so the point is that how can I create an economic model or how can I create a return on investment on my property when actually there is no economic model for the city. Everybody wants to leave the city and I am thinking of going back. So the problem is that the bigger problem has to be solved. So I was sitting with this idea and I read somewhere what is written over there that if a problem cannot be solved, enlarge it. So it really hit me. You know, there are two stories about it. I'll also like to tell a small story like Samir said. So listen carefully. I went to a friend's house and his dog was sitting in the corner. Everybody listening?
Yes.
So the dog was sitting in the corner and was moaning. Thoda thoda ro raha tha. So I said, what's wrong with your dog? So he's saying that oh, actually jahan baitha hai, niche nail hai. There's a nail underneath. So I said, why doesn't he get up? Well, it's not paining that much also. Itna bhi dukh nahi rahe. So the things are there in your life because they're not really paining you so much. So I said that really the right way to do this is to actually chase the bigger problem. The bigger problem is that our city doesn't have an economic model. And the actual problem is that if I solve the bigger problem, then my problem will become the smaller problem. So that was a decision to be made. So I was sitting there for 3 months just thinking, and I knew that if I take this decision, then it's going to be a one-way ticket because it's a rest of the life ka pura kaam hai. So here I am a builder, you know, coming from the SG Highway and this is a 2-year project. Now I'm trying to commit to a rest of the life. But as I said, that what Samir said, what makes you happy? Because a lot of people said that pagal chu, itne mein to 5 projects ho sakta, you're wasting your time. But I said, this is making me happy, right? And I'm making good enough money, which is okay. You know, so I really asked myself that why did I do what I did? So what came to me is that I do what I do because it inspires me. And being inspired is being happy. See, remember the feeling when you're happy, you feel light. You know? So being inspired. So I want to be inspired. So this inspires me. Number two, I do what I do because I want to be challenged. I want to solve a difficult problem over here. And third thing is that I want to make a difference. And what Samir said, that you have to be practical, you have to make good enough money so that you can do it. So my model is that till now, my business, construction business is allowing me, giving me the freedom to do something which really inspires me. And now after 8 years it looks like that I am now kind of headed somewhere. Okay. So I started working on this and then I started being called to various circuits of economics of heritage and my knowledge started increasing. And this is what I came up to. One of my friend who works in Blackstone and he had constructed a business plan to raise money. He started a company where he had raised 35 crores and it was a service industry. And he is an MBA from London and I'm just a BC. So I once called him and told him that, can you help me construct a plan? So I just saw his PowerPoint presentation and I came up with this value chain. There's a film which has been made now, but the point is that if you see on the right, what we need is a flood of money to go to the old city. And these are the other three things which has to happen. So to create awareness. So I made a hypothesis that Ahmedabad, if it has to be a World Heritage City, we need 100,000 visitors to go to the old city every year. And if that happens, then a lot of things are going to change. So I'm not getting into the detail of this, but there are various things. And the other thing is that any idea which I thought is a great idea, I googled it and it's already there in the world. Hello. So think about it. Point is, are you ready to implement it? Are you ready to pursue it, right? So what Samir said is the second principle is, in fact, the three principles. One is to follow somebody, find a mentor or find somebody whom you think you want to replicate or be. Second is to immerse yourself, and third is to pursue, never give up, like the stamp. So these are the various ideas which I thought, and this is already there. So this is a Italian village in which they have this model. So what I started doing was that on the right hand side, if you see that capital intensive venture, so we need to have models where investments could be attracted and a return on investment can be made. So this is a El Burgo Difuso, where a village, each house has a room or something, you know. This is a very interesting way of doing things. So I thought, why can't we have it in the pole? So now this is the Dhalni pole, and these are the various buildings which we have identified. So from now, what I am trying to do is that I am trying to get 20 people buy properties in the old city and have 5 properties as a showcase, that we have mobilized 7 crores, 5 crores of our own in 2 buildings. And Abhay started his property, new restoration corporation is. So we have 7-8 properties which are already showcased. And now I'm approaching 20 people, and this area is my model area. I'll tell you what is the plan for India, because India cannot be like Europe. Europe is a totally tourism model. Everybody agrees, right? Because in India we have a lot of people. So my model is that if we could have in 1,000 houses, we could have 20 restored houses. And each house is an investment of 2 crores, then we are actually getting 40 crores go back to this area. And for every one restored house, 50 houses would be community houses. Now, how do we elevate the quality of life? Because Indian inner cities will always have people. So it's to make good toilets. So we need good toilets. We're making low-cost houses in the periphery of our city. Why can't we have low-cost houses in the old city with a sensible development? You know, nice studios in the old city, 15-20 lakh rupees houses, but very nicely done. Okay, so I'm going to show you what we have done. But now my goal is to construct a model which would have various players, HNIs, who are happy to make a high net worth investment and have a nice property. People can own a farm, why can't they own a Haveli? You know, microfinance companies, like in the old city, no housing company is making loans. So if we can organize this sector, then we could have finance. NGOs, toilet makings, and the corporation should come in and make the streets, signage, and suddenly we'll have a model which is working for India, and we have hundreds of cities across the world. Okay. As a social enterprise, what I am seeing is that I am not looking at how much money I am making in this, because I am happy making the money, but my goal is set, that this is what I want to achieve. So that is, I said that the approach is a social enterprise, because if I think what I am making, I would have never been able to do any of these things. So this is one property, the French Haveli, which I just mentioned, and this we recently took over, and it had just 2 bathrooms, and we completely redid it, and we put it online, and this is the website, and we are doing very well in, we have 70% occupancy in the last 6 months, and booking.com is saying 8.9, TripAdvisor is saying number 1 in 173 properties, so we are doing the groundwork, and the difference is, that people don't, there's a Simon Sinek says that people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. So I say that I'm not a hotelier, but you come to my rooms, I'm saving my city. You are helping me to save our heritage. So that's how I sell myself. So that's what I'm doing over here. These are the other properties which we have restored. So we have now scattered rooms in the old city. We are managing 13 rooms. Localites are involved. So there's something going on. This is a local hostel we have created with beds and localites. We are creating very unique partnerships, and eventually we think that there could be hundreds of rooms in the old city which could be absorbed. And if we have hundreds of rooms, then we could pick people up from Ellisville Law Garden. So all things are possible, you know, the scales have to go up. So these are the other things which I have looked up at, that we need repair funds. So there could be a fund which could come in. And then TDR is coming. There's a practically 200-300 crore TDR. So all those things have to be worked out. So point is, there is a detailed plan, but still a lot of things have to happen. So I'm in middle of it. As I told you, I'm still sweeping the floors, but the passion is on. So this is a model approach we have taken up. Also, we are engaging the communities, because the communities, till they don't want heritage to happen, it's not going to happen, right? Because in the European cities, things got gentrified. Gentrified means that the original people move away and the entire area becomes a tourist destination. This is not going to happen in Indian inner cities. We need the local people to be involved. So we are doing various things with the local communities. So there is a whole plan. We are working with various NGOs and we have designed heritage walks in the Dhalmi pole. This is a very interesting new thing which we are launching with Chocolate Room. We are starting rickshaw tours, old city rickshaw tours from Chocolate Room. If anybody buys 500 or 1000 rupees worth things from Chocolate Room, they will get a free rickshaw tour going through Siddhi Siddhi Jali, Jama Masjid, Swaminarayan Temple, all those places, and ending at French Hill. So ways and ideas how to connect the new economy, right? So I end my presentation over here. So still I'm halfway and hoping that the World Heritage nomination will help us accelerate. Thank you very much.
Who was your mentor who helped you taking awesome decisions which helped you achieving towards your goal or rather growing towards your destiny?
Okay, great. I didn't have a particular mentor, but reading good books really helped me. In fact, they say that the books you read and the people you meet will make the person you are in the next 5 years. So I read a lot of inspirational books and I find a lot of answers in that. And that really started communications from inside and reflecting.
Can I add to that? I think everybody said no. Forget about mentors. Everybody you talked to said nano. I think very important to
more passion.
So it's, exactly. It's commendable.
Sir, what do you suggest to the young entrepreneurs if they want to do something related to the restoration? As students aren't aware of how to convert the site as a business.
Well, this is an upcoming field and eventually I think in the next 10-20 years this could become mainstream, mainstream business. There are various facets of this. There's a lot of intangible part. It's the creative economy. So it's good that if you could start working with somebody who is like passionately involved in this and understanding the thought process. So maybe 2 years and working in the various aspects. So restoration is one part, but how to, you know, brand this and market this and the various aspects.
I believe this is the stock exchange. Really.
That's right.
So that is from where new ideas generate, new ventures come out. You have a great idea. You have a room full of people who are doing heritage management. And the numbers that you are talking about are not really that difficult to raise money. So do you have a plan where we can, you know, academic people, students can work as interns and we can take these ideas forward?
Sure, there is a plan.
So then if there is a plan, then we have a lot of students who are doing heritage management. There are a lot of students who want to do something different. And we can integrate and raise the money, take this forward. I mean, real estate investment trust, the government of India is working on that. So the rental income model that we are talking about is not something which is going to be very difficult once the law gets passed. I mean, if parliament works, that's a big if. But I hope, I'm an eternal optimist. So if you have a plan, I think we can raise, I mean, there are a lot of HNIs over here. We have a builder accessible also. who might be interested in other surplus capital. So we can think of it and we can engage. And this is also to the both of you that we have so much human capital which is available. So if we can think of plans where we can work with industry and our students can be interns so that they get start getting all this real life world exposure from college itself. That would be a great thing.
Sure.
I think also if you look at happening just with the innovative ways that people are doing things, the largest real estate hotel, I mean the largest hotel company in the world today, is companies like Airbnb and Oyo. They don't have a single room, they don't own anything. The largest transport company in the world is Uber, they don't have a single car. So these are the kind of things that would work, that there is existing rooms available, waiting, but they're not being put to use because the network is not there.
That's right.
Right? Just like the cars were sitting in a parking lot not being used until somebody came with the idea of this whole network. That is the kind of thing that we should focus on, which these kids should do as part of their internship project or something like that. To come up with those kind of ideas, why can't we have, if we have rooms available, there is social media today, there is so many other ways of communicating with this, with the audience. Locally.
That's
international,
right.
National, I think they get much more exposure than we are doing locally. Why can't we have local tourism? So those, I'm just saying,
that
is a wonderful thing for the students to work on.
What is, there is no question that ideas, whatever you say, are not. Only thing is that for something new to happen, there is a big amount of political will which needs to happen. So most of the struggle with people have been going through heritage is because the lack of policy. Otherwise, there would be no story to tell, you know. Land lidi bandhi na, so what's the story to tell in there? So that is one area. So now, because the World Heritage nomination has become into being a contendant, there could be a pressure. This is what I am guessing now, that there, because from the central, only one file has gone, so we could use this as a positive pressure. And the way to deal with this is just to make a SPV. It cannot happen at the same level. Like the riverfront project would have not happened if the municipality was dealing with it. So SPV has to be done. So all point is that we all know what can happen and what should be done. But so the point is that what the students could do is we have to start advocating that we, because wherever World Heritage Cities got being successful, there was a lot of advocacy. So advocating that why our city deserves to be a World Heritage City would get attention. And that is, see, why 1 lakh people? Because then that will make the policymaker compelling that they have to do something about it. See, this is very small compared to, but since it's a cultural domain, they are not able to get the attention of the policymakers. But there's no money to be spent, right? Anybody else?
What kind of mindset did it require to recognize heritage as a kind of opportunity for culture?
Well, a lot of things have been done by intuition. So I have not done much research. I like first took the decision and then did the research. so little bit, see, but I believed in it. But I had a mindset of being somebody who don't want to give up. And I had a strong feeling. And there were a lot of odds, like I said, my wife didn't agree with what I'm doing. And she gave me a challenge that if you don't make this much money in this, then you better say goodbye to heritage, you know. So that kind of, mindset was not giving up and believing in yourself. And what I tell people that once you immerse yourself in quicksand, then you'll learn to survive in quicksand also.
Because the research in cultural entrepreneurship generally says that it is the character who is culturally entrepreneur, not the material, not the kind of environment, but it is the character.
But point is that whatever I'm doing is being done everywhere in the world. The challenge is because of the lack of awareness and the lack of, like these rickshaw drivers, They charge 150 rupees per hour. And there's a whole team of rickshaw drivers. We had a group from Bartlett, London School of Architecture, and I thought they must be very organized and they must have made that planning of the trip. And the morning they came and they said that we don't have any plan. So I called Mohammed, the rickshaw driver, and he did an architecture tour. So the point is that all this has to be taken to the next level.
I have a question.
Yeah. That's right.
And if, how are you going to involve the people, the residents of that entire missing area, unless you are able to get that people will.
Right.
Political will is fine, but people will drive the political will.
That's right. So the advocacy is about that the World Heritage City would actually involve more of the people living in the old city. They wanting...
You need to involve them.
Yeah.
Even if they start doing something for their own problems, for their
That's right.
Looking like some of the European students.
That's right. So, point is that community engagement, like what you saw over there. Last Sunday, we had a treasure hunt. One of the corporate company, we asked them to do a treasure hunt and involve the localites, playing the local games. So, there are various things which are being done. Knowledge is already there. Shoo karwano cha baddu khabar se. At what speed we want to do it and how fast we want it. See, like this TDR, 300 crores and 2000 building, if corporation or government is not going to be proactive, it's going to take 500 years. So we need to really sit down with a table and chair and give, I want this 2000 buildings to transfer the FSI and get it done. Now that has to be an approach. So that is what is missing. Yes.
Whichever the area was, how did you shortlisted that those 20 houses and the owner of that place, or you might have faced challenges in getting those places probably.
Yeah, so local, building local relationships.
How did you overcome that?
We are building local relationships.
Local relationships.
Smiling.
So the, probably the neighborhood might get more encouraged towards that, or they might have created more problems.
See, as I told you that our model is very simple, 5% or 10% tourism, 90% is going to be community development.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Your courage is truly motivational. I'd like request Professor Keshav Bhatia, professor in charge of the e-podium, please come up here with a vote of thanks.
Well, on a lighter note, one thing that has been made very clear is the wives have a lot of say. Mr. Sinha, sir, thank you for delivering such a motivating talk. You beautifully touched upon the importance of passion, relationships, and the need for an unbiased mentor. Entrepreneurship demands disruptive ideas, demonic energy, undying passion. This is a thought I am sure students will remember for the rest of their life. Mr. Patel, sir, thank you for giving us the confidence to think differently. It was truly amazing to hear of your hands-on approach to entrepreneurship. We should all remember that it is ultimately a decision that leads to success. Thank you for sharing your vision of Ahmedabad as a heritage city and the commendable work that you have done towards it. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank once again all our speakers for accepting our invitation and taking out time from their busy schedules to interact with the students. I'd also like to thank our director, Professor S.G. Trivedi. Ma'am, thank you for all your support. For the core team of the e-podium, you all did a fantastic job and you all should be very proud of yourselves for the job. Thank you for standing by me and in believing in the importance of this event. Last but not the least, I appreciate the support of all the student volunteers and our friends from the press. We started the e-podium with the simple objective of, and the second, what really is our true purpose in life? Thank you.
Students, there's tea and coffee arranged outside, and sentences are in T4. Thank you.